Good morning, to one and all present here. I feel extremely privileged to welcome you all to this session. And Chitkara University publication is an open access initiative of the Chitkara University, where basically our purpose is to provide the open access content to the scientific community, to the scientific community, society, without any paywall. So Chitkara University publication, actually, like I told you, is an open access initiative of the Chitkara University, and we are publishing 9 platinum open access journal. When I am saying platinum open access journal, it means that we are not taking any article processing charges. And we publish all the article with the Creative Commons license, CC BY license, and all the articles basically are preserved. There are some highlights about the Chitkara University publications. As I told you that we are platinum open access journal, sometimes people use it diamond also. So platinum and diamond both are same. Platinum open access journal follows single blind peer review process. We basically provide all the copyrights to the author and as well preprint accepted for the submission to all the journal. And we are fulfilling the criteria of coalition S group, that is known is in terms of the plan S. And in addition to this, we are the member of the Committee on Publication Ethics, that is simply known as COPE, basically member of the CROSREP since the inception of our Chitkara University publication. We preserve all the article in the preservatory of the PKPPN clocks, available on Publon server, all journals, and we have connected all the articles with the PLMX, so we can find out all the scientific as well as social contribution of each article. And you can read and find out us at the Sherpa Room. You to know about our open access policy for all the manuscript version. So here in this slide, you can see that we had started a journey since 2013. And since then we are providing to our DOI to all the articles. And recently in 2019, we became a COPE member. And in 2020, we had completed all the criteria to fulfill that plans. And in 2021, that is very important for us. So we become the member of the United Nations SDG Publisher Compact. And there are so many activities basically which we do to fulfill that SDG criteria. And last week, basically last month, we had celebrated the peer review week in terms of the SDG Publisher Compact and many other things. At the same time, we are the EASE member, European Association of Science Editor Membership, we have. And the most important thing that we had collaborated with the America, and America is the UNESCO project, and they are providing us all the technical facilities in terms like that we were publishing earlier PDF format, our article. Now they are providing us technology to convert it into the XML, into the EPUB, into the HTML, as I told you, EPUB, PDF simultaneously, MOBI version. So all these type of facilities basically they are providing, and very soon in the end of this year, we basically provide all the formats to our journal. So this is our journey, and we are growing with respect to time. As you know that we are traditional teacher, but now we are learning about to the publishing. And as I told you that we are platinum open access journal. There is no article processing charges and all the rights to the author. And now I will request to respect the Dr. Archana Mantri Ma'am, Vice Chancellor Chitkara University Punjab Campus, to welcome respected Dr. S.K. Vasini sir. Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sushil. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. First of all, I take this opportunity to welcome and also thank at the same time Dr. Vasini who is advisor and head international cooperation department of science and technology government of thank you sir for accepting the request and be here with us we have close to 100 participants now most of them phd scholars and the rest of them researchers to hear from you what the topic that you have chosen is what is the usefulness of doing phd to introduce to the audience about Dr. Vashne. Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Vashne is the head of international scientific cooperation in the Ministry and Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He joined DST in 1990 and is facilitating international scientific cooperation from the Department of Science and Technology with its bilateral, multilateral, and regional scientific partners. He is also the Indian co-chair governing body Indo-German Science and Technology Center and Indo-US Endowment Fund, member board of directors of a private limited company, Global Innovation and Technology Alliance, GITA as we call it, and is member governing councils of the US India Education Foundation, USIF, and International Advanced Research Center of Power Metallurgy, ARCI. Apart from many other positions that he has held and is currently holding, he has worked as counselor science and technology with the Ministry of India and UNESCO to facilitate bilateral scientific cooperation between India and Russia during April 2008 to June 2011. He is also the Life Fellow of Geological Society of India, Bangalore, Nepal, Geological Society, Kathmandu, and member of International Association of Sedimentologists, Oxford. We welcome you, sir, and we will be very, very eager to hear from you. Just to give you a little background, I'll take about 1 minute of the universities, the two universities which Dr. Sushil has already told, and I'm sure he must have briefed you about what are the audience and what is the from where we come. So these two universities, one of them, you know, the first campus established in 2002, but we started as a group of affiliated colleges to Punjab Technical University. And the other university started as a university in Himachal Pradesh. Together, we have 20,000 students on board in higher education and about 3,000 students in our K-12 school. We have presence in 4 states as of now. Sir, we have been ranked in top 25 institutions of the country in terms of research and innovation and entrepreneurship by ARIA, Atal Ranking Innovation, ranking that we have from Ministry of Education. We have also been consistently ranked in 100 to 200 rank band of NIRF. Recently, we have been accredited with A+ grade from NAC. This is just about a month back. We have total 40 research centers and center of excellences in both the universities. And also we have filed over 800 patents together from both the universities. About 125 of the patents have been granted. 50 technology commercializations have already taken place. We have also been recipient of international funding from Erasmus Plus. We have got 5 projects in capacity building and research also from the European Union. Some of the highlights and the final figure that we have today standing at about 40 crores of funding together, both endowment, research, and capacity building funding from international and national agencies. Over to you, sir, and welcome once again. And we are very, very eager to hear from you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashna ji. And thank you, Sushil ji, for inviting me. Nice introduction. Thank you. I would like to add that currently I am serving on a committee constituted by Punjab government on revival of academics, research, and industrial connect post-COVID. So I would be happy to take your input for the same, that how Chitkara and other universities in Punjab could contribute to this industry connect. And I'm so too happy that you are having Erasmus projects and also you are doing a lot of industry-related incubation, etc. So I think we can separately sit down for that. As far as today's my talk is concerned, what I'm going to speak today, they are my personal views. And this is such a subject where anyone can have any view. So it is not necessary that you have complete sync with my thought process. But idea is just to provoke you, just to make you feel what is happening and what we can do. And Sushilji will recollect that we started on this topic during a LinkedIn debate on this topic. And idea was that my job is to facilitate science. And I have been going to different campuses. Meeting a PhD student, sometimes is a pleasure, sometimes it is a pain. And well, pleasure you can understand, but pain I'll just try to explain you in a couple of minutes. Problem is, when you meet a research scholar, primarily a PhD student, ask that fellow, what is the topic he is working on? And he will immediately tell you, this is my topic. And then you ask him the second question, how is it connected to a bigger problem? Or what is the utility of your research? He says, I have no idea. How did you select this topic? I didn't know. My guide gave me this topic. So problem is, our researchers feel it is just like another degree. They have done graduation, they have done masters, and now they will do PhD. Whereas PhD is a different ballgame. Here, you are not expected to vomit out what you have studied in the classroom or mugged up from your books. But you have to be your creative best. You have to be original thinker. And that is why I was a little disturbed, little puzzled. So I thought we could discuss with the research scholars why and what we can do. So then I started exploring myself why people are doing PhD. So one of the obvious reason is that they want to obtain another degree. Second reason is they are waiting for the golden moment. And that golden moment could be anything. I am writing competitive examinations. I need hostel seat. So I would join a PhD program. There is no development in my family, and my family wants to get me married. And until I get married, I am doing PhD. There are several good options which our students are hoping for to come in timely, but then they are doing PhD for that field. Other thing is, people feel that since there are UGC guidelines, if they could do a PhD, they will at least get a job of a lecturer or a faculty assistant professor somewhere. That is at least secure. So they would like to do PhD. And what they are doing in the process, you know, sometimes we get exposure to wonderful research, but many a times we are not getting that. So now I'm trying to coming on the good aspect of it, that someone of them are really interested to generate new knowledge. And this is a positive side. So first three may not be so exciting, but the next one, trying to generate knowledge, trying to publish. Now this is another folly, because our researchers feel that the only aim of research is to publish research papers, which is not true. Publishing is a milestone. It's a stepping stone. People should go for a lot of publication. I'm not denying that. But publication is not the only goal of research. We need to go beyond that. And what is beyond that? We need to see how we are trying to solve a challenge. Now, a problem being faced by your city, being faced by your state, being faced by your nation, nobody else will come to solve. You have to solve it. And this is where the focus of research should be. So you can publish, you can patent, you can do whatever you feel like, you generate new knowledge, but then you need to solve a problem. So if you are going in that direction, you are going for a good PhD, but if your goal are first three, then I am afraid that it would be another book which would be stacked in the library and nobody will refer it in future. And you are not interested in fact for that problem. So I have put some couple of the cartoons just to make you feel that somebody feels that I already know truth, or somebody who says that I am going to do my own research. I want to ensure that what is the truth. The most important question is whether research makes you happy. You know, unless you draw excitement, happiness, satisfaction from the research, you will not do it. And you would be primarily focusing yourself on variety of other things but research. Remember, everything is not everyone's cup of tea. So even research is not for everyone. What are the other options? You can set up a business. You could set up a startup company. Nowadays, a lot of new ideas are there. A lot of schemes are there from the government. And you could set up your research plant. You could join the industry. So you need not to work very hard. And you whatever knowledge you have got during your bachelor and master thing, you could just join an industry. Or you could enter into another field called communication. Now, what is happening? We are not having healthy communication in our newspapers, in our magazines, in our TV or social media. So what is happening? That we are getting a lot of political stories, sports stories, business stories, but where are the development news? Where are we highlighting research in our media? Okay. And we need a very, very specialized person for that job. So if you have a flair for writing, if you have a flair for presentation, I would suggest you take up a career in something like science communication. It could be a social science communications. How development is taking place? If we could take it to the society, that would really be very exciting. Other thing could be, you can think about and go for policy formation. So a lot of opportunities are there, and government is making different kind of policy, be it economic policy, science policy, education policy. You name the subject, we are constantly working. And these policies are revised after every 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, whenever there is a need. These days, in addition to policy, government have also started having a long-term vision. For example, now my department is working on Technology Vision 2035. How India should be in terms of technology security in 2035, already process has started up. So people could go for those things. Another beautiful career for science graduate and postgraduates, even for engineering graduate, postgraduate, is to protect intellectual property. You know, this is a career because a lot of our people are not aware how we can protect our property, how we should file patent, how we should protect patent, how we should encash patents. So these are circumstances which needs to be guided. So I think there are a lot of other options. If you are not doing research, you can go for this. But remember, if you are going for research, you should draw satisfaction. You should draw happiness. If that is coming to you, then automatically other things will come. Now I'll come to the second part of my presentation, which is what are the things you could do as a researcher? So who are researchers? In fact, that is a very, very fundamental question. A lot of people feel only those fellows who have done their masters, they are the researchers. People working in the academics or research institutions, scientific institutions, they are the researchers. But I feel anybody at any level, if the fellow has curiosity, he's a researcher. I'll ask you a simple question. How old do you think the term nanotechnology is? You may feel 100 years. But what if I tell you that this is more than 10,000 year old concept? For ages, our mothers are collecting carbon in the form of kajal. Okay, that is nanotechnology. All of us are used to beautiful taste of chutney. That is nanotechnology. You are grating it at a nanoscale. People of our generation may recollect Vaidyas who were giving us grated powder because they knew that the herb has a different property at nanoscale. So what I'm trying to tell you is there are a lot of technologies which are known for quite long, but they have not been documented scientifically, not validated scientifically, and that is why we are not we are feeling that nanotechnology is only 100 year old. But leave nanotechnology, even let me give you some other examples. Our person in the chef, normally mother, wife, sometimes gentleman, they are all researchers because they are trying to make a better cuisine than yesterday. Okay, so they are thinking different combination of condiments and spices just to get best taste. Okay, our farmers are researchers because they are seeing how to get a better crop yield next year, how to minimize use of insecticide, pesticides. They are researchers. People who are working on the floor of industry, they are researchers. So I feel, let me give you one more example, just got it. School children are researchers. You know, aap kaam karke nahi gaye ho, teacher ko bahana marna hai, to ek naya bahana banana hai. You are a researcher. So curiosity is the prime driver if you are doing research. And then remember, there is no comparison to something what you have experienced. For example, all of us, or rather most of us, have done the cycling. And even if you have not touched cycling for 20 years, after 20 years, if you are using it, you will have no problem. Because that is something you have learned by doing. Okay. It may be difficult for you to remember what you read 20 years ago, exactly. But anything what you have done, what you have experienced, you will never forget. And remember, research is such a game that you need not to succeed all the time. Failures are part of the research. In fact, failures are the first step which takes you to a better direction. That why something works in nature, why something does not work in nature. So you get driven by that aspect. And remember, you cannot be a researcher if you wrap yourself in a comfortable situation. Okay, everything that is happening, let it happen. So that way you will never be a researcher. Now, I have used two pictures. Why research is necessary? Now I am coming to that aspect, why research is necessary. And I have used here two pictures. One picture shows stored water or standing water, and another one is moving water. And the obvious difference is, while moving water is fresh, the stored water or standing water has got a lot of other things, a lot of undesired things. So you get stale if you are not moving. So if you are not doing research, your knowledge level get stale. Similarly, all of us are living in a competitive space. You know, I think most of us might have seen the movie Three Idiots, that even to take birth, we have to compete. How do we get admissions in any courses? Everybody knows it's a race. And when you are going to buy a new mobile phone, you are always seeing what is the best available in the market at the money I can afford. Okay. And you will not compromise on that, because if you have fixed up a parameter, this is what must be there. So whatever your budget allows, you will go. So products are there, but they are in a huge competition. And to make the product better, you need to do research. Remember, if you are not doing research, you may lose the battle. I think all many of us would remember how did Nokia lost the battle. Nokia was the first company in the world that came with the mobile phone. But they decided not to go to a smartphone. And that is where they lost. We had our own HMT watches. They did not stood the test of time. They failed. They did not cope up. They went back. Can you imagine, we had two cars, Ambassador and Fiat, which ruled India for nearly 50 years, and they did not change. And what happened? Suddenly, the Indian car market got flooded with a lot of new cars, and they were vanished. So if we are not doing adequate research, we will go. There are a number of other examples like Kodak photo films, which are no more there. There's so many other things. So what I'm trying to say, that you need to constantly improve yourself. And second thing is, when you are doing research, it's not that reaching the first milepost will give you results. The moment you reach there, you will find another challenge. Okay, so the moment, it's a competitive world actually. So the moment you reach one milestone, another milestone is always looking for you. And then we can have situation like COVID. You are suddenly locked. So what will you do? You know, those who are students, those who are faculty, they know how did they cope up with the education. Suddenly, smart classes, which were used to be the ornament of an organization, and they used to have two or three or five smart classes, suddenly entire thing converted into smart classes. We had our own challenges. For example, nobody knew which platform they would be using. And it took time to standardize that this organization will use this platform, be it Zoom, Webex, Microsoft Teams, or whatever platform. So it took time. When the COVID came, we were not prepared in terms of treatment, because doctors did not know how to treat COVID. We lost a lot of lives. What is the situation today? Most of the COVID patients are treated and sent back home. just learning of 1.5 year research has given us that confidence. We could produce vaccine. We are now going into preventive care, giving our citizens vaccines against COVID. And this is possible only with the research. Something which was not necessitated before, but because it was required, you were forced, you came out with the solutions. And remember, we are not the only country who did it. Then a lot of tens of countries who came up with several COVID solutions, including vaccines. But if you forget these tens of countries, there are more than 200 countries who did not know how to handle it because their research base was weak. And today, a lot of countries in Latin America, Africa, and Asia are on mercy of those countries who did research. So research is a very, very important thing and could play a vital role not only in development of knowledge, development of economy, development of strategy or political powers. Now, if I could say what is research, then first aim is of course looking for new information, new understanding, and new facts. And then I would like research to be used for solving problems or increasing our available knowledge. You can use it to test existing theories, make new observations, and it teaches you to be systematic, organized, and objectives. So if you need to classify it in different parts, you need to define your goals, you need to go how I go for it, what are the quantitative aspect of my research, what are the qualitative aspect of my research, and then you have to see what are the potential example which are existing before you start your research, and then after you have done this. Now, coming to the challenges, because journey is not smooth. So first challenge is non-existence of scientific training. Now, many of the universities are going for compulsorily PhD training program, which is of about 6 months or 1 year, where students are trained how to do research. Unfortunately, they are only teaching that you have to see how to get information from the journal, you have to see, but they are not teaching what you are expecting out of research. Okay, they are not, they are saying that your goal is only to publish, but only publishing is not goal. Patenting, filing patent is considered an achievement, which is fantastic, but filing patent is nothing. Because then after filing the patent, we have to see that we get it. So granting of patent. And then once patent is granted, then you have to protect it because others should not make use of it. And after you have protected, then you have to see how should I encash those patents. Unfortunately, there are no such training as of now on all these aspects, which I would recommend universities to take into consideration. Second thing is financial issues. Now, of course, there are national level examinations conducted by many bodies, be it UGC, CSIR, ICSSR, DBT, Atomic Energy, but still nearly half of our students are not getting any financial assistance. You know, they can survive on their parents' money, but to do research, they require consumables, they require equipment, they require books, they require other things. And for that, they are searching here and there. So this is a major constraint. And then lack of communication with the guide is another major challenge. You see, there are few lucky persons who get regular discussion with their mentor, with their guide, but majority of them would not be meeting their guide for weeks and weeks. And they are meeting once in a month, and that meeting would be for about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and then they will suddenly exchange note. So you can imagine, this is such a thing, such a relationship where communication is the key. In fact, after each experiment, a student must tell to the guide or mentor whether he could do it successfully or there were some challenges. And if there were some challenges, how to overcome them. And we should see how it is going. Other thing is, students are not aware about proper time management. This is a very serious thing, because at the beginning, nobody knows if I need 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Sometimes people take even 6 years or 7 years to complete. So it just shows that they have not done proper time management. So my suggestion would be that if you could frame your questions, after framing the question, you should allocate time, and also you should divide your day, how much time you would be doing in the lab, how much time you will be giving to the library, how much time you would be giving to the discussions with your colleagues, peers, lab mates, floor mates, and your mentor and guides. So I think this is something we have to do. And then there are a lot of stress. I think I need not to elaborate on this aspect. Each one of you understand the kind of stress, and this stress is not only from academics. Family se bhi hota hai, to get married, to get job, and a lot of divergence is there. So I think those stress have to be taken care of. And confidence. Many a time, students are not confident of what they are doing. And they need some extra efforts to generate that confidence. Normally, a good guide, a good mentor will always motivate a student to do something good, boost up his morale, boost up his confidence, but majority of them lacks this. And next problem is not of the student alone, it is of the system. If you need an equipment and there are money available in your lab, but there are rules which will say you can get an equipment through such and such process, this may take 3 months, this may take 6 months, this may take 1 year. Okay, you want certain chemicals, which is quite expensive, so you have to follow a different route. You know, the moment you have identified your research question, your guide has visualized what kind of equipment is required, where you will be doing it. Sometime you have to do it in some other institute, because your institute does not have that facility and other institute is not giving you time. Okay, so these are the challenges, and guide should have. And next thing is library. The library has changed over a period. Still, we have got physical format and electronic format, but our students, I'm not very confident how much they are making good use of physical library or those things which were in the last century. Today, most of the data which is in electronic format is of the current century. But historic knowledge or legacy knowledge is still in old books. And how many of us are going through that is a challenge. So this is what I have tried to summarize the challenges, some other challenges like how to do reporting or how to do reproducibility, payment, plagiarism, ethics, funding. There are several challenges researchers need to know and need to address, because only knowing is not enough, but you need to address. So if you meet a researcher, the fellow, suppose somebody has done research, the fellow is still not sure that I have a lot of data, done a lot of analysis, searches here and there. How should I go forward? This is a constant problem which we need to address. So my suggestion to the PhD student would be, always know what is the purpose of the research. Are you generating new knowledge, or you are working to find a solution to an existing problem or challenge? So if you know the purpose, you would be doing it accordingly. Now, I'm just giving you some examples, running very fast. Managing the crowd, this is research, okay? And we have learned a lot from Kumbh Mela. If you remember Kumbh Mela earlier, there used to be a lot of accidents, but these days, Kumbh Mela are accident-free, okay? Another thing, what we did not learn during COVID, is still our people come in groups, in masses. So crowd, while we could manage on a given function date, like Kumbh Mela or any other Mela, we are still not able to reach to the masses to make them realize that issue like COVID, how we could avoid being in crowd in the market. Food. Now, it's a huge challenge. It's a challenge for the scientist. It's a challenge for the farmers. It's a challenge for the society. It's a challenge for the geography. So whatever subject you are reading or studying, food is a huge problem. Now, I'll just give you an example. We are a country of 1.3 billion people. And in the process of industrialization, we are losing agricultural land. We are losing agricultural manpower. And our population is continuously on increase, which means that while we will have lesser area to grow crops, the number of mouths to be fed will increase. Okay? And this requires that we should not only improve the way we do agriculture today, so yield has to increase, but also we need to improve upon post-harvest losses. We lose a lot of things when we are transferring crops from the agricultural field to the dining table of my house. The loss is huge, and we need research how we can minimize that loss. Okay, there are better packaging technology, there are radiation technologies. And if you talk about social impact, I understand background is researchers from all sections. So if you're talking about social dynamics, it has a huge impact. There are villages which are getting floods, which are getting drought, and immediately the entire village is affected. So we need to take care of those things. Affordable healthcare. You know, India is home to 5-star hospitals, and a lot of global medical tourists come to India to take treatment. But what about our common citizens? Are we able to provide them solutions? It is a subject of research, not only for the pharmaceuticals or chemist or biochemist or biologist or people in medicine. It is a subject of concern to our social scientists. It is a subject of concern to our planners, to our managers. How we can provide healthcare at affordable price. And you see, even the location of hospitals, there are rural areas, remote areas, hilly areas, where people have to travel more than 100 kilometers to get a simple test done. can we not provide them healthcare facility, screening facility at lower step? Why should they travel such a long? Energy is another challenge. You know, India is energy deficient country. And we have tried all possible route. We started with thermal energy or coal energy, hydrocarbon-based energy. We went for hydroelectricity. Then we went for nuclear plant. There were a lot of political resistance, so we could not increase our nuclear plants. Now we are working on two kind of energy, or three kind of energy, if I could say. One, we are working on bioenergy, biofuels. Second, we are working on smart energy, renewable energy, which could come from a variety of sources. It could be sun, it could be air, it could be waves or tidal. So different kind of energy are being. Third thing which we are trying is energy, stored energy, which is primarily batteries or capacitors, which we are developing for our automobiles, for how our bus will run, tomorrow's bus will run, trucks will run. So different kind of energy are being discussed. And there is also discussion to create a smart energy grid, so that if you are drawing energy from one format or the another format, you should still be able to use it in a comfortable way. So this map, this picture I have taken with some wind energy, some solar energy, and some traditional energy. And our tomorrow's home are going to be fit with smart grids, where we could have import and export of energy from our systems. Water is another crisis. You know, you are sitting in Punjab. Punjab groundwater has depleted. And now there are a lot of new diseases which are coming to Punjab because the soil which has got deficient in water is releasing chemicals. A lot of chemical leaching is taking place. And because of that, I still remember the train from Punjab to Rajasthan, which is called Cancer Express, primarily for the reason that water is not good. And it's not a problem with Punjab only. Several parts of the country, for example, downstream Ganga Basin. Ganga to kehte hain pani amrit hai. But downstream, we have got arsenic rich water. People in Bihar and Bengal have complained that they are getting badly affected. And see what marketing companies have done. Marketing company have told you that any water which you get, whatever treatment it has been done, it is bad water. So you must have a home-based treatment plant. So people are using AquaGuard, people are using RO, people are using filters. Everybody is using it. That is the marketing. So marketing is also research. So to create a mindset in you. So we need to conserve our water. We need to, another problem, because I'm just mentioning it is, you are from Punjab, that is water budgeting. Now, water budgeting means that normally if we see our fresh water, the maximum use is in agriculture. And we know that there are crops which require less water or more water. Okay, Punjab changed. Punjab went from wheat growing area to paddy growing area. And suddenly, water requirement increased, because paddy required a lot of water. And Punjab did not have that water. That is why you took it from the groundwater. So in terms of money, paddy gives you more money than wheat. But in terms of health, you are a loser. Because nobody thought earlier that we need to budget water also for such purpose. So there are several issues. Now, transportation. Yesterday, nobody was sure when the next train will come, next bus will come. But today, we are very, very confident that, okay, next bus on this route will arrive in so many minutes. Okay, even when we are driving ourselves, we are using navigators. So navigators are playing a huge role in developing intelligent transport system. And these are our futures, which we'll be seeing. There are a lot of new emerging technologies which are coming into play. And each of these technology will have its impact on society. And social scientists have to come up and meet that how these technologies are affecting. I'll give you a very simple example. 50 years ago or 60 years ago, we were living like a king with no disturbance. But today, our homes, we have got a huge web of electromagnetic waves. All of us have got mobile at home. We have got broadband. And we are exposed to invisible electromagnetic waves. And we don't know how it is going to impact on our life. Similarly, during COVID, we have become over-dependent on virtual media. And we don't know how it is going to impact our eyes in 10 years from now. So question is, each new technology that comes into the market have some impact on the society, and we need to study that. Remember, the first thing that changed the first major thing that damaged the earth was industrial revolution. Even though it increased production, it produced first large-scale pollution. Okay, so that pollution was not only air pollution, but also chemical discharge. So nothing comes, so nature has its own way of balancing. We are trying it one way, nature tries another way. And the thing is, we have to be responsible for all our activities. So whatever anthropogenic activities are taking place, we are responsible. Now, what helps research? A good rivalry. If you are competing with someone, he has published 4 papers, I'll publish 5 papers. He has filed 1 patent, I'll file 2 patents. That spirit of rivalry helps research. And then when you are doing research, you start with question A. But when you are midway, you find that there could be another question B, which you could answer with the same process which you have learned on the way. So you get a lot of newer idea when you are pursuing research. Most important thing, my sincere advice to the students would be to follow ethics. I think this is the key aspect of research. You have to be ethically very clear in terms of integrity, in terms of principles, in terms of fairness, conscientiousness, and idea is simple. Don't plagiarize. If you have taken something from somewhere, do give appropriate acknowledgement. You know, it's not difficult to quote someone else's work, but then you should never claim some other fellow's work as your work. So ethics has to be very, very clear, and they are very important. And then once you have developed a product, then branding plays a role. You know, like soft drink, why we are calling them Coca-Cola? Because it's an image that has gone inside us. Okay, people are not asking burger, they're asking McDonald's. If you go for online shopping, people are asking Amazon, Flipkart. Why? There are several options. So creating a brand value. For example, I told you a little ago about the water filters. It's same creating brand value. making you used to. So when you are doing research, you are developing a product, another kind of research is required to get you established in the market. And when you are getting it established into the market, at that time you have to displace the existing player. So you have to be disruptive in your approach. And you will hear this term more often, disruptive technologies, in time to come. And now coming to the last part, what research can give you is, it gives you tool how you could build knowledge and how you could facilitate learning. It will give you access to the latest informations. It would help you to understand issues and increase public awareness of a particular subject. It will help you to succeed in your business. It will help you to disapprove lies and support truth, to find goals and seize opportunities, to promote love and confidence in reading, writing, analyzing, and sharing information. It also helps you in personality development, so that when you are sharing your research with a wider audience, you are being regularly questioned. And once you answer them satisfactorily, you get more wider audience. And this greater visibility enhance your reputation, impact of research, and also bring in a lot of external funding. So your external funding is dependent on your previous work, and you are considered a responsible worker in a given field. Remember, PhD journey is not a competition to see who is fastest to finish or who has written highest impact paper. The easiest way to do thing or having viva with no corrections, PhD journey is your journey with your research. Simply enjoy it. What I come from Department of Science and Technology, so I can tell you what my department can offer to the science students. We are providing support in form of junior research fellow, senior research fellow in DST supported projects. We are not conducting any examination of ours, but we are respecting if you have passed any examinations by any system. We also encourage you and support you if you would like to present your work in international conferences, symposiums, and to participate. We are providing short-term fellowships when you are pursuing doctoral work. This is for a period of 3 to 6 months to provide overseas exposure so that you can see what are the best practices being followed in other countries. And there are programs where we are supporting full-time postdoctoral research. And for those who have got settled in as a faculty, we are also providing early career research grant. So with these, I would like to close and wish all your students a good journey, an enjoyable journey, which they would find exciting on their way forward. And I would be happy to take any questions on the subject. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. With the broad spectrum, you had discussed many things. And especially, I will try to highlight one important point that you had mentioned, that is research objective. Research objective should be very precise and for the long term, not for the PhD degree. If you are aware about to that, only then you can survive into the research area. Otherwise, if you will plan the research objective just for the PhD, then you will face the problem. If you are a faculty member somewhere, then how do you will search the problem? Again, the same problem you have to face at that time. If during the PhD, you are capable to define the research objectives for the long term points of view, then only you can basically can come to the real problem. Right. So this is the point. And sir, if you will allow me, I can share some points through this slide. So
yes, please.
I want to bring in your notice that how basically the publication of the India basically facing the problem at a certain age, and the points basically related to that data can give some insight to all the researchers that today we are facing this problem and what may be the reason of it. Some points basically I had in my mind, but I want to bring out this thing with you, so you also understand that. So through this slide, sir, I want to highlight some points, and this is about to the India ranking in terms of the publication and data is taken from the SciMago JR website. In 2009, we were on the rank at 9th number. Documents that were published was 69,000 in the first line, and citable documents were 64,000. So these were the documents that were not cited. And the overall citation, we got this much number, 1,245,855. And self-citation, over this number, 410,000. And the difference was this one. And citation per document was 17.98. It was in 2009. But you can see successively in 2010, our ranking was at 9. This is country rank, and 2011, basically in 2010, everybody knows about that, what changes basically are done at UGC level. And then after 11, 12, 13, 14, I had noticed at this point, and I had, the point was related to the self-citations. Up to the 2014, you can see that self-citation were increasing, and after the 2014, what happened that self-citation has decreased. This is a good point that in India, we had basically started to reduce this number. This is a good point from the ethics point of view. But now what is the point actually you are not required to cite your own article? If you are working on a successive on a problem that you are basically doing the research on a problem and successively publishing the article, you required some basically the oldest article where you had started. This is the another phase of this self-citation. Here I'm clearly mentioned to all the PhD students, there are two points that I have mentioned. Self-citation is not a good part in ethics, in research ethics. I try to avoid it. But on the other hand, if you are working on a problem that that is great, gradually, basically, you are working on that. So you require that you had done this work in past, and now you are working on that. You are not required to provide all the information that you are had already published. Right. So if I see that point from 2014, self-citation has been going to downward side. And at the same time, our country citation per document has been reduced 0.76. This is alarming situation. So my point is here that if you are, and I had concluded it because I have limited time, so I cannot explore everything. So I had concluded that if you are not defining your research objective properly, then what you will do, either you will collaborate with the other person that is not related to your field for the survivalness into the academic domain, or the practice will be totally different. Now you are writing this particular specific article on this particular topic. Tomorrow, after 6 months, you will switch on a different problem. You will write a different article. So this is the point that I want to share with you all. Please precise your research objective, first of all. Sir, now over to you, and your any specific remarks on it.
You are asking me?
Yes, sir.
No, I really appreciate this analysis which you had shown. And I would suggest that consistency is a major consideration when you are doing research. So when you are doing it in a given field, we expect you to gain more and more strength in that field, rather than migrating or jumping from one field to the another. Because if you are a hopper, then you are not considered a specialist. So you have to define your own narrow zone and also your broad zone within which you would be working. And you have done a very good analysis that self-citation has come down, but I was really worried that the overall impact which was shown in that is coming down. That is rather not good, and which means that probably we are going in journals where others are finding it difficult to cite. So I think we need to improve upon that. And our publication must be of highest quality. They must be relevant. And I'm sure once we do that, we'll attract better citation.
Yes. And now we are open for discussion from the research side, from the audience side. Please, if you have any question, either you comment into the comment box or just raise your hand. Please. Karthika, are you there? One scholar is associated with us as a co-host. Do you have any question? Or from the audience, one can ask the question without any hesitation, and they can ask anything related to the PhD or like that, or related to the overseas funding or like that. Because sir is taking care of the bilateral program, so if you have that kind of question also, so you can ask, please. Karthika, are you there? Yeah. Do you have any question?
I have no questions.
Okay. So let me ask one question to you, that you are doing the PhD, right, in Bhartiyar University, Tamil Nadu, right?
Yes, sir.
So when you had selected your research objective yourself, or your supervisor had given to you?
Sir has given.
Yeah. Till that, we are taking one more question from the Dr. Rajneesh Sharma, sir. Sir, please go ahead.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Dr. Vashne. It was an excellent presentation. Thank you so much for sparing your valuable time to address our research scholars and all researchers at Chittara University. The day would not have been so good without your presentation today. Thank you so much, sir, for the presentation. In fact, I've already typed my question, and I think that question has gone to the host, Chittara University, but I would read it from there only. So regarding library, what I've asked is from your experience, if you could share some pearls of wisdom with us, like how one should motivate students of today. Today I had written in single commas to visit library on more frequent basis. And this question is very pertinent, that students of, again, single commas written today, like to study more from online resources, and situation is especially deteriorated during COVID time. Very, very difficult, sir. But to motivate them that, okay, you should go to library, open books, prepare notes, because they believe that everything can be done through online resources only, including attending the classes. Anyhow, they have been attending since last more than 1.5 years. Most of the universities are having online examination also. So somehow, unfortunately or fortunately, this trend is getting established that perhaps a visit to library is not at all required. I would just like to hear from you. What do you feel about the same, sir?
Very sad about that. And forget COVID, even in pre-COVID time,
correct,
the number of visitors to library had dropped down like anything.
Yes.
And this is not a healthy trend, because still not all books have been digitalized. And lot of legacy knowledge is in our old journals, old documents, memoirs, which must be conveyed. Second thing is that there is a difference when you are reading it electronically or you are reading it through the printed format.
Yes, sir.
Because when you are reading through printed format, you refer it time and again. And sometimes you even remember the page number on which a particular information is given.
Absolutely.
Now, we need to inculcate that habit. And maybe you could ask students to give some assignment, especially when they are doing the initial part of their research, like literature survey,
mm-hmm,
that they have to tell what happened in last century, what happened before that in their field where they are focusing. Because unless we give them questions which are based on the information which are in the books available in our library, it would be really difficult to motivate them. And I feel so sad, actually, when I go to some universities to check the assignment. Quite often examiner to their M.Tech, M.Sc. examination. People will copy it from Google or Wikipedia, and they will not even remove the hyperlinks.
Yeah, you're right. But you would be, yeah, that is absolutely. But you would be glad to know that, sir, in Chitkara University especially, we're having that policy of academic honesty. We try to make it sure that whatsoever even assignments they do submit, those also get checked through these plagiarism softwares like Turnitin and Urkund, etc. And yes, we are in special research.
No.
Papers, 100% we are doing that. But
thank you, Rajneesh. No, academic honesty is fine. But coming back to your original questions, that how we could motivate them to read books, how we could motivate them to read journals, memoirs, which were published long, long back. I think we, as a faculty, have a responsibility to give them questions so that they are forced to explore answers from them.
That's absolutely right. Wonderful suggestion, sir. We'll try to get it implemented. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Again, I would again appreciate all the appreciation for your wonderful presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Dr. Sushil, other opportunity may be given to other question, other people as well who want to ask questions.
Yes.
I will mute myself.
Yes. Asutosh, sir. Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm myself, Asutosh Kumar Pandey, and I'm a doctoral student. Professor, I have a question related to the appointment of the professors in university. Currently, I'm in Yonsei University in South Korea. So when I checked any portal like IITs, NITs, or any central government university, they said like your bachelor's and master's means 2 degrees in the same department. As the professor presented, you should select a goal and a problem to solve from the society, to solve a problem from society. So my ultimate goal is to solve or to develop a renewable energy resources, means like a production of renewable energy. But my degrees are different, means I started with the biotechnology, B.Tech in biotechnology, and then I got interest in bioprocess engineering. So I shifted to biochemical engineering in my master's, and now I'm doing PhD in civil and environmental engineering. So how it will be good for me, or it?
Ashutosh, I missed part of your talk, especially the later part. But what I understood from your question, how does the mixed degree help? I'll tell you, at least 2 examples I know personally. So I'll quote those 2 examples where people, after doing graduation in medicine, MBBS, they jumped to engineering and they did PhD in engineering. Okay. So they have best of 2 worlds. They know what is happening in medicine world and what is happening in engineering world. So mixed degree are always good. And organizations like IIT, NIT, they are not focusing that what are the discipline in which you did your degree. They are more focusing on what you are capable of delivering. That aspect has to be taken care of. So when you are applying for a faculty position, you in a given department, they will ask how you can contribute to that department. So that is the more important thing.
One more question from Dr. Mehendar. Yes. Yeah, please.
Good morning. I am Mehek from working in Department of Science and Technology. And I would like to differ from Rajneesh Sharma, who was saying that people are using more and more electronic things. Maybe it has started after COVID, but I myself did some research on it, and which was related to how people are using digital resources and print resources, especially in the field of biotechnology. And I did it in the select university libraries of Haryana and Delhi. So the results were that it's okay. People are shifting to, no doubt, people are shifting to the electronic medium, but ultimately only the print media is the thing which is having some elite benefits and which people ultimately prefer at the end of the day. So it's not that only online medium or digital medium is getting more and more marks. It may be because of COVID these days, but what I got to know after my research was this, that people are still preferring print media over digital media. This is what I wanted to say.
So anyone else? Kartika, I was asking to you.
Yes, sir.
Mahek ma'am, something else? It's okay.
Sir, actually my guide, that is Professor Balasubramaniam sir, gave me the full freedom to choose our own topic, sir. And moreover, he gave the proper guidance to complete the work, sir.
The question that was pointed out in the beginning of the presentation by Dr. S.K. Vasne, that when he basically, or everyone asked to the research scholars that, you had defined the objective. Yes, we had defined the objective, but what are the outcomes of your objective for, in terms of the scientific point of view or in terms of the society?
Sir, according to me, basically PhD can give many advantages, sir. Like it can help us to gain self-confidence in our own personality, as well as it helps to it helps for a skill development, and also it can be, the PhD tenure can be used as a time to win many competitive exams, and finally I think it can improve our careers in our after PhD life, sir.
Together with all these attributes, PhD also gives the stress. Do you feel sometimes stress?
Actually, I didn't find any stress, sir. Though I have got some paper rejections, but still, I'm coping up with all these.
Great, great. One thing I want to say with you all, personally, actually, nowadays I am associated with the publication. So what I have to observe, being in addition to the regular researcher, the question related to the library the answer basically is related to the in terms of PhD scholars. What I had observed, actually, I personally feel there is a gap between the librarian and the researchers. At the present time, what is happening that everything is available online. There is no need to go into the library to find out the journal and to do the copy. So everything is available online. But what remain else? Because of that, researcher have to approach to the library. That is the bibliometric study, that is the scientometric study, that basically only the librarian can provide, right? Nowadays, what is going on? If you have to review the articles, so there is no need to write everything. I accept that for the subject specific point of view, you have to read. But to generalize 1,000 paper, what the technology you require, that only the librarian can provide. But what is going on? Librarian are doing that kind of exercise for the library purpose, for their own purpose. They are not providing that information to the researchers. So this kind of observation, when I had observed, I called some librarian and discussed, why you are people not sharing all these information with the researcher? So why are not providing a specific domain research to the researchers, so they can get basically this kind of training and save their time. So this point actually, Vasne sir, I was thinking to say in reference to the online and offline activity and the connection with the library.
Oh yes, I agree with you that these are some of the good suggestions, and even fellows who are from the library should come up and share the information which is with them in different forms to keep the student excitement level high.
And if anyone is interested, again, I'm asking if there is any question. So I will say, I will ask to respected Dr. Manuja, sir. Yes, sir. The respected Kuldeep Bhasin, sir, are most welcome. And
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can you listen to me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Vashne, I'm really pleased to listen your talk, and I can conclude this thing that you have traveled from Delhi. You have not only traveled from Delhi, you have taken the DST along with you to come to Chandigarh. And I really feel so privileged to have listened your talk, and I have remarked also that one of the best lecture I have ever heard recently. And you have not only guided, you have not only updated the PhD students, you have also guided matured and elderly people like me also. I think this is one of the most excellent talk you have given. Thank you very much, and I wish this talk would have been recorded so that it can go to the people around. Thank you so much once again. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Blessings of people like you are motivating me to go further.
No, thank you so much.
I was told that this is recorded, so probably Shushil you would be sharing it on university website or somewhere.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And on the personal side, I'm in touch with Dr. Vashne a long time back, particularly when he was in Russia. So I still remember all these things. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, sir.
Basin sir, do you know the beauty of his presentation? He always put some pictures only in the slides.
And okay.
Basically message directly from the picture and the explanation, and I am so much impressed.
Thank you.
And thank you for your comment, sir. And now I request Dr. Manuja, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, respected Dr. S.K. Varshne, respected Archana ma'am, our Vice Chancellor, Chitkara University, respected Dr. Sushil, and my dear faculty members and research scholars. It was indeed a very, very absorbing session we all experienced today morning. I must commit that Varshne sir has been at his best of knowledge during last 40 minutes. Provoking ideas and thoughts among all of us. Vashne sir, you rightly highlighted that we must ascertain the utility of our research before proceeding with our PhD work. Just to quote one offline example, in the US, the first and the foremost alignment and evaluation of your PhD work is simply whether you have solved some society problem and whether you have converted your work into a startup. That's what you touched upon very nicely, sir. We in India are also slowly heading towards that aspect. A very important point, Vashne sir, you have raised. Whether the research work we are doing makes us happy. This is one very important question we all scholars need to answer ourselves. Vashne sir, during today's session, it was wonderful to understand who are researchers. Curiosity is the first and the foremost parameter, and the linkage with nanotechnology, real life scenarios, with farmers, with daily life examples have been very apt in the context of today's discussion, sir. One simple line, if we want to be researcher, we need to come out of our comfort zones if we want to make a mark out of it. Example of Nokia, Kodak, have been very relevant when it comes to research. You rightly pointed out that they lost the battle because they did not do aggressive research in their own field. And COVID crisis definitely is. It has taught us the importance of research, whether it is smart classrooms or healthcare or anything per se. Vashne sir, your thoughts on simplicity of research is nicely rephrased in an idiom which goes like, the most complicated skill is to be simple. So that is what you nicely pointed out during last 40 minutes. That's what Kuldeep sir has also highlighted. Dear research scholars, I'm pretty sure that you may correlate yourselves with the challenges Vashne sir has highlighted for the PhD students. So let us start working on these challenges and convert them into opportunities. PhD is not like other type of graduations. It requires extreme self-motivation, focus, enthusiasm towards the research work, and peacefulness. To be successful in PhD life, you have to be using each day as an opportunity to improve, to be better, to get a little bit closer to your goals. This is one activity where you can give the world a reason to remember your name. Mind it. I'll repeat the line. Give the world a reason to remember your name. Vashne sir, towards the end, I, on behalf of respected Dr. Ashok K. Chitkara, our Honorable Chancellor sir, respected Dr. Madhu Chitkara, our Honorable Pro-Chancellor ma'am, and entire Chitkara fraternity, would like to extend our sincere gratitude towards you for enlightening our research scholars as well as faculty members to learn the relevance of what we are doing, why we are doing, where we are doing, and how we are doing. You nicely touched upon those things, sir. It has been wonderful to have you on board today as our guide, as our mentor, and we request you to keep guiding us in coming time also. Sir, we look towards you for guidance when it comes to working on education, research, and innovation post-COVID in Punjab. As you shared in the initial beginning, that you are on a government committee to guide the state on these aspects post-COVID. So we look towards you for the guidance in coming time also. Many thanks and wishing you a great day ahead, sir. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much. And the only message I would like to give to our young community, Generation Next, journey of 1,000 miles starts with the first step, which is very important. And you need to decide what is going to be your next step. So with those words, thank you very much. And it was a pleasure interacting with Chitkara. And I would seek your suggestion if you would like to give to Punjab government on any aspect, what you would expect, how university could contribute in further improvement of Punjab academic industrial connections.
Definitely, yes, sir. We'll touch base offline, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you
so much, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye for now. Namaskar to everyone.